Hello. Good evening and welcome, everyone. I'm Carla Chianchi. I'm the site director here at the Helen Diller Family Preschool, which, if you don't know already, is the preschool right upstairs on the second and third floor, one of our three preschools here at the JCCSF. I am delighted today to be able to see all of you here. It just reinforces how committed we all are to such tremendously essential and vital work for our children and our communities. Tonight, we have the pleasure of being in communication and dialogue with Britt Hawthorne and Natasha Iglesias. Britt Hawthorne is the author of the 2022 New York Times best-selling Raising Antiracist Children, a practical parenting guide. Britt is also an anti-racist educator, a teacher, speaker, visionary, advocate, and she is committed to raising a generation of anti-racist children by centering families of the global majority and fostering equitable learning environments for students and children of all ages and of all backgrounds. Britt's work moves the idea of equity in education from a goal to a reality. She partners with action-oriented educators, much as many of you are here, to making that goal, again, turn into a reality, creating classrooms and environments that are inclusive and equitable for all learners. Compassionate and challenging, Britt's voice continues to be sought after for trainings and workshops at schools and universities across the nation. Tonight, she brings with her Natasha Iglesias. Natasha is the co-author of Raising Antiracist Children, and Natasha's writing has appeared in journals and magazines such as The Isolation Journals, Third Point Press, Lockjaw Magazine, and many, many more. But what makes this evening even more impactful is that it's made possible by the collaboration of many of our preschools. Not only are we here as the JCCSF and three of our campuses, but joining us tonight is the community of Cow Hollow, if you can raise your hands. Hi, Darcy. And the Little School. I know Elise is there. Thank you. So again, combining all of our forces in one consistent goal. In reading your book, which I had the pleasure of doing over winter break, I kept returning to the same statement. Community is at the heart of anti-racism. Thank you all for making the commitment to be in community with us all this evening. And please, if you will now give a warm welcome to Britt and Natasha as we move this conversation further with respect and grace. Thank you.
Happy New Year, everyone.
Hi, Happy New Year. I'm Tasha. I use she, her pronouns. I'm, as mentioned, the co-author of this book.
And if I'm new to you, I'm Britt Hawthorne. I'm most affirmed by she and they pronouns as well, and I am the author of the book. We are excited, delighted, and just energized to be in community with so many of you tonight. What we have planned for you is probably about 40 to 45 minutes of us talking about some central themes of the book. Then we're going to open it up for a Q&A. So feel empowered to think about some questions, and you can come up. Don't be scared at all, but you can come up to the mic to ask your question. And then towards, at the very end, we'll have a book signing for anyone who has the time and space capacity to have your book signed by us. So thank you so much for being in conversation with us today. I think we wanted to start the conversation with some guidelines. You want to talk a little bit about that, Tasha?
Yes, I do. these were discussed with Britt and I pretty early on and these aren't set. I think it's important for anyone who's going to be approaching difficult conversations or conversations that really need to be led with intention to collaborate on guidelines to make sure that those conversations are as successful as possible. Mm-hmm. So some of the guidelines that we agreed upon so far today are?
The one that I love is approach conversations with curiosity. I think that's always important to say, I'm going to be really curious. I'm going to ask more questions than probably offer statements. And I'm also going to listen more than I'm going to share.
Yeah, seeking to understand. Another one is approaching with empathy. Not everyone is at where you're at. Not everyone has the same knowledge that you have. And so it's important to, when educating, when creating bridges, to create those bridges with a level of compassion.
And then our last one is really just holding space and being able to both advocate for yourself, but also hold space for the other person when they say, I've had enough of this conversation. When we're thinking about having these conversations, we're oftentimes thinking about having them with loved ones. So whether that's your parenting partner, your spouse, your beloved, your mom, your grandma, your children, but they're people that you're in relationship with. So you don't have to feel like you need to have the entire conversation at once. You're going to see them again. So it's okay for the person to say, I have reached my capacity in this conversation. I need to take care of myself. It's okay for the person to invite you into some grounding techniques. And these are really beautiful moments to model for our children as well. What does it look like to stay engaged and to sustain yourself in a conversation? And that means that we're not going to have to not only have this intellectual conversation that we're going back and forth, but that also means that we're staying engaged in our bodies, right? There's so much of this work that lives in our bodies, and I don't know if anyone else is feeling this right now, like feeling the tension, feeling the activation, feeling the nervousness, feeling the angst, feeling the frustration of everything that is happening in the world right now. It is important that we take care of ourselves, that we're doing grounding techniques, that we are also modeling and showing them with our children too. So those are our guidelines that we came up for tonight.
Yeah. Specifically also about the grounding and the checking in with yourself, I also think it's important in relation to that is what are your priorities for the conversation, right? And what are the priorities for you? You're not going to completely change someone's view. You're not going to solve a huge crisis in one conversation, typically, usually. So being kind to yourself and noticing what is possible for me, what might be possible for the participant of the conversation, what can we agree is a small success? And keep that in mind. And if it gets overwhelming, to do those grounding exercises and to know when to maybe pause that conversation so that way you can come back to it another time.
Yeah. So without further ado, we want to dive into the conversation since we have those guidelines. One of the things we wanted to talk about is New Year, right? So it's the new year for many of us, and I'm not for sure about you, but when I start to think about, and I shared a little bit on my, even though I'm taking right now a social media break, which has been life-giving, but last year, I shared on my Instagram, this is the first time that I've ever started to dive into the new year with an anti-racist lens. Like, what does that mean? Who is it the new year for? Who it's the new year not? And I also then started to think about some practices that I did in my home growing up. So in my home, we usually would stay up to midnight. We would have some sparkling cider. And then we would make resolutions that didn't last beyond 48 hours. I'll be really honest. But what I do remember is witnessing my mom and the women in my life make a lot of New Year's about their bodies. And I can vividly remember that. I remember them buying the new diet plans, the box foods, purchasing the Tupperware, purchasing new foods for the house, throwing foods away, and then just the conversations that they were having about their bodies in that way. And as I'm so glad I am not right now currently on social media, but I remember last year, the diet culture and just being inundated with it. So that was my experience. And every time that we are thinking about practicing anti-racism, it always starts with that raising awareness. What is it that I know and what is it that I don't know? Tasha, how did it go for you in your house?
Let's also agree to honesty today as much as possible. I grew up in a very fat phobic household. I mean, I've had messages about my body being wrong since I can remember. I remember my father visited me. My parents were separated. He came to pick me up on the weekend, and I was like 8. And I rushed over, and I gave him a big hug. And I remember him, like, gripping my little squishy love handles. And he said, like, Gila, you need to lose weight, at, like, 8 years old. And I don't – I'm sure everyone here understands that when you when you remind a child over and over that their body could potentially be an issue, you're not making a healthy adult. You're making an adult with body image issues, right? Can I have a show of hands? How many people know the phrase new year, new you, and specifically around body image, weight loss, body management, diet? Okay, that's a lot of people. What an insidious phrase, new you, better you.
I know.
When we're talking about messaging and starting off the new year with intention, right? How are we revisiting how we view ourselves in a society that is constantly trying to make us unhappy with who we are, what we look like, how we show up, what we wear, and specifically that the standards that we are forced to try to comply to are standards of a white supremacist,
Eurocentric
beauty standard that is just not achievable. And even folks who get close to achieving it don't feel like they can. So how are we looking at how we show up for ourselves, and how is that being examined by the children in our lives? Because children are always watching.
And it reminds me, there's a person who wrote a practice in the book, Katie Kitchens. And in their practice, they were talking about perfectionism. And it's not as if it's not as if their parents ever said, you are imperfect or you are not perfect. But it was all the times that they made a mistake that let them know, I am not perfect, because of their response to it. And I think about the same thing with the new year, new you, is that we are implying then that we are broken and that we need to be fixed. And we have to ask ourselves, at what age did I start to learn that? Did I develop it? Did I think it? Did I have the mindset? So when we're working with really young children, we have really young children in our lives, and we're being thoughtful of the ways that we're talking about ourselves. We're being thoughtful the way that when we look into the mirror, how do we react about our bodies? And that when our children come to us and they say something like, I don't like this role, or I don't like my thighs, or I don't like X, Y, and Z, instead of saying something like, oh, but I think you're so beautiful. You're just the most beautiful person in the world to me. Because when we share that with a child, what we really aren't telling them is, I don't want to hear what you're saying because it makes me uncomfortable. It's telling a child, I'm not going to hold space for the hard things. It's telling a child, I'm not going to help you to figure it out. Instead, we can simply say, you know, I'm so glad you shared that with me. There are things about me that I'm learning to love too. Can you tell me more? That opens this connection. It invites conversation. It creates the space, because let's be honest, at some point in our lives, or maybe right now, there are things about us that we're learning to love. And then the conversation turns to, what can we do about it together? Versus, oh, better not tell me because I can't hear it. I don't want to listen to it. It makes me uncomfortable. I think you're the most prettiest thing in the whole wide world. And so then therefore you should think that too. And then the conversation is over.
Can I just ask? I'm doing a lot of like asking at y'all. I hope that's okay. It's engagement. Can I just ask, for whenever has anyone's like expressed discomfort or disappointment with their body and they've had a very well-meaning person in their lives go, no, or you're so beautiful. Does that work? Do people feel heard, and do those negative feelings go away? And we know they mean well, right? And we know they are supporting us as like our loved ones. But that voice outside doesn't change the voice that's been inside, that's been like bred into being by society as a whole, right? That person can mean it, but it might not convince what's in here. So starting that work early on, and I say this is true, I'm going to continuously be so annoying. I'm going to be like, this is true beyond ages 0 to 6. But it's true. How we model the way that we view ourselves, the way that we try to work towards loving ourselves, or at least towards accepting and honoring that we are who we are and our bodies are our bodies, whatever, in front of anyone is more impactful than rushing to go, no, you are beautiful. And you can say those things too and mean them. It's not shutting anyone down. You guys can call me beautiful as much as you'd like. But modeling that, it starts at a very early age as being impactful, but it doesn't stop being impactful, right? Everyone here can feel the impact of seeing someone truly accept themselves, love themselves, or at least make the commitment to working on it, regardless of age.
Mm-hmm. And that's why in the book, if you have a copy of the book, you'll see the practices around the affirmation. It was really important when we were writing that activity, we were writing that practice, that that is a practice that's coming from within for the child. It's not something that we are giving them pre-made cards that they have to write or that we're telling them what to say, but instead that they are generating it from themselves, what is true for them. And for young children, that it is already difficult for them to find truth and the beauty within themselves. Instead of having them try and come up with something that doesn't feel genuine to them, just start with the smallest truth. So sometimes they can just look in the mirror and then they can just say, I see brown eyes. Mm. I see blue eyes. And these eyes can X, Y, and Z. And just move out from there. I notice eyebrows. Or this is how I notice my mouth. And this is what my mouth can do. It can enjoy some really delicious ramen. And just start from what is true in the smallest ways possible. So again, happy new year, everyone. You already have homework now and things you can do. I think the other thing though, I really wanna talk about, what do we wanna talk about?
What's in there? Well, when we're talking specifically about messaging, right? We are messaging constantly to the young folks in our lives. How we think about ourselves, what we think about other things, how we exist in the world, how comfortable we feel taking up space. Mm. We are showcasing the ways that we are participating in a variety of communities, the community of family, the community of like our actual community, and for them soon, the community of their schools. Mm. So you all did a pretty amazing thing and you all came together in community to put this on and create a resource for everyone. Like, we're all here learning together. We're going to engage together. We're going to chit chat with y'all. This is an active act of community that you all are investing in.
Yes. You can keep going, but I just had an aha moment.
This is like all of our Zooms. It's just,
I know. And I'm like, and I'm telling her, I'm like, just keep going. Get your idea out. I'm going to hang on to it.
But another thing that we wanted to talk about when it came to setting intention and building community was to approach teachers and community members within the school system with that same intentionality. And we were going to talk about a practice.
Yeah, can I back up a little bit on my aha?
You may back up.
Okay. So remember how we were like, it's really important to ground the conversation with guidelines. The other thing that's really important is to make sure that you have a shared definition of what you're talking about.
Oh, I know exactly what you're about.
I know. And I'm like, oh, we're 25 minutes in and we're talking about raising antiracist children and we haven't defined what? Yeah, we haven't defined anti-racism. We haven't defined racism.
This group is so smart.
I know, right? These are my people. And that's really important because having different definitions can lead to your conversation being derailed. I'm gonna give you a really quick example. So over the summertime, I went and I spent some time at my parents' house. And my dad is in the kitchen, he's making French toast, and he kind of asks but really tells. I think we all know that feeling. And he's like, my name is Brittany, but I go by Britt, just FYI. He's like, Brittany, you never experienced racism growing up, did you? I wish I had y'all there in the background. And in that moment, like, immediately started to get defensive. Like, are you kidding me? Tell me you haven't read my book, Dad, without telling me. So, you know, I had to collect it, take a deep breath. And I realized in that moment, we are missing each other somehow. And it's in that small gap. I said, well, Dad, will you tell me your definition of racism? And then I could answer the question. And so he goes on and he starts telling me stories that I have heard and some that I haven't heard. But really, awful, horrific stories of the racism that he experienced growing up. Physical abuse, violence, name-calling, threats, that kind of nature. And I realized what he meant was, had you ever been harmed, physically harmed? And so I could better understand and more empathetically respond to his question to say, Dad, no one had ever physically hurt me growing up. And you could just kind of see like this. And it also gave me a little window of maybe why he hasn't read my book yet. Maybe he was too nervous, right? Like sometimes like we want to know, but does anyone raising a teenager, anyone? My heart is with you. Right, because I have a 17-year-old. So it's like we want to know, but we don't want to know. Right, like I'm looking at his phone, like all the experts say you should do a screen check. And we'll just talk about it. So I said, you know, according to your definition, Dad, no, I did not experience racism as a kid like that. But then I started recalling, I said, but remember that time when I walked with a friend, I had went to my neighborhood elementary school, and I walked with a friend to play on the playground. I had a friend over. And I said, remember the house that's right next door, and there's a fence that divides. I said, remember when those men came over to the fence and started yelling the N-word at me, and we ran home. And I said, and I told you, and you were so angry, and you called the police, and you wanted them to do something, and the police said, there's nothing we can do. I said, remember that time when you were really, really sick, and we had to stop at the pharmacy to get some medicine? And I have two older sisters, and we were a little unruly, I'm not gonna lie. Our parents were definitely like free-ranged parents. You know, like in 5 minutes, meet me at the register. And then we kind of went off. And I remember a manager following us. And I, in my heart and in my head, I just knew I did something wrong. And I couldn't figure it out. Like, so I remember just kind of like changing the way that I walk. And I remember like smiling. And then we came up to my dad and we told my dad, we're like, the manager is following us. And we don't really know what we did wrong. And we were looking for my dad to tell us so we could do better. And my dad to this day still does not cuss. It's really funny. He's like repeating stories and he'll still be like, and then they said H-E double hockey stick. And we're like, okay, Dad, you know, you can repeat it. But you don't need my permission. Go right ahead. So he pretty much read him a new one. And I remember that. And so then I like shared two or three other stories about the educational racism that I experienced. And I said, so I did experience racism. I was disadvantaged in many ways. I was name called. I was excluded. I was doubted. I was denied access in many ways, but not in the way you're talking about. And so I think it's so important that when you're having conversations that you and the other person or you and the group of people or your coworkers that y'all are saying, what is our definition? What are we talking about here? So in this conversation, there's a variety of definitions that you can use for racism that all kind of mean the same thing. Inside the book shares some of those examples. You could say, let's say you're talking with your parenting partners or your coworkers, it might be just simply racism as a system advantage, where white people are advantaged and people of the golden majority are disadvantaged. That one's really clear cut and to the point. So it's not my favorite definition to use with children. Because with children, we want them to work what? Critical thinking. We want them to work on their what? Critical thinking. Oh my, they are really smart.
This group is so smart.
Oh my goodness.
So
that one really takes away and eliminates a lot of critical thinking. So for young children, you might say, oh, it's personal prejudice plus misuse and abuse of power by institutions, which kind of feels like a mouthful, so you have to make it really concrete. Let's say you're telling a story about Mrs. Rosa Parks. Raise your hand if you heard that story, Mrs. Parks' story. Yes, and I do intentionally call her Mrs. Parks out of respect, right? She is, for me still, would be an elder. And so many people, so many black folks, so many black women were denied that respect of Mr. and Mrs. at that time. And so if you know that story, let's say we want to use that definition with that story. It then becomes, who had the personal prejudice when we're telling the story. So we're flipping, we're reading Nikki Giovanni's version of Mrs. Parks, and then we can come across and we read the story, or we read the section with James Blake, the bus driver. And we can say, oh, James Blake had personal prejudice. He had a belief, an idea, an assumption about a person or a group of people without even knowing them. And then as we kind of keep reading the story and you learn that James Blake had asked Mrs. Parks and the other two black men to move out of the neutral section, right? They were not in the what we would call the colored section. They were in the neutral section. And he asked them to move. And at first, all three were like, nope, we are in the neutral section. We are where we're supposed to be. And he's like, I don't care. So he puts his hand on his gun, and he's like, you will move or I will move you. And so the two black men took care of themselves, and they're like, I'm out of here. Like, today is not going to be the day. And Mrs. Parks is like, no, I'm going to stay here because this is wrong. When James Blake then calls the, he arrests her, or he calls the police to, for the police to arrest Mrs. Parks. At that point, now we're moving into racism. Because when we talk about the systemic misuse and abuse of power by institutions, with young children, we're like, oh, so the bus company had laws, rules, policies. Who else had laws, rules, and policies?
The police department.
Yeah, the police. And then she actually was booked. She was arrested and booked. So who else? Yeah, the criminal punishment system, right? So you have all of these then institutions and systems that are colluding that allows a person to have not just that personal prejudice on an individual level, but for there to be discriminatory action. So while that definition is kind of a mouthful, you try to make it as concrete as possible. Is that helpful? Okay, there's some more in the book along with scripts, but just to get us going, because we did want to talk about schools.
Yes. Before we talk about schools, though, there's just one thing that you mentioned that fascinated me, which is when you were talking about trying to get on the same page about what racism meant with your father, you said, violence, abuse. And what's so interesting to me is that in addition to getting on the same page about what racism means, I feel like you're also getting on the same page about what violence is, right? Because violence can look like more than just physical assault, right? Any kind of microaggression, any kind of like institutionalized pain and trauma is a form of violence. And that is also something that we should keep in mind as we are moving forward, because I think it illustrates, it indicates the gravity, right? These are lasting wounds that make a huge impact and shape a person's life and shape a community and shape a society. So if we call it with the impact that it actually provides, if we name the thing a word that actually is a bit more weighty, right? Then I think we can also approach that conversation, hopefully, with a bit more of a recalibrated understanding of what's at stake in that conversation. Just wanted to throw that out there.
Yeah, because I think the language, what we're saying too, is language is so important because it can be both a tool of oppression, but it also can be a tool of liberation. And it's also important that we have accuracy in language because it dictates kind of the weight or the severity that we take of it in a situation, right? So if someone just tells me like, hey, I'm feeling under the weather, I'm feeling a little sick today, I'm not going to make it. I just like, oh, I hope you feel better. But if someone is like, hey, I was just diagnosed with cancer, I'm not going to make it today. I'm like, oh, okay. What can I do? Do we need a meal train? How can I support? So while you can both think of them both as sickness, there's this level of language that is so important. Can I tell another story? Okay, let's do another story really quick. I'm going to share the story about Kobe in school.
This is a good one, guys.
And this story is going to illustrate kind of the power of anti-racism and why it's so important to raise anti-racist children at home. So Kobe is my youngest son. He is now 11 years old. He's in fifth grade. And earlier this year, I think it was maybe in October, I'm not for sure.
Earlier this year?
New year. Same me. I might coin that. Okay, earlier in this school year, so like October,
Love good that catch. Pivot.
Important. Language good is pivot. Important. Precision of language. So it's pickup. It's Friday. It's pickup. And if you have young children, you already know how pickup goes. It's like a whirlwind. So I'm chatting with my friend Mary, waiting for the children to get dismissed and come out. And so next thing you know, we see my child and her child, and they're just kind of like coming right at us. And her child was really upset. My child looked bothered. And I was like, oh boy, what's the drama today in fifth grade? Right. And then her daughter was just like, something awful happened to Kobe. And so I was like, oh, like, what's up? And so I kind of immediately just took Kobe to the side and was like, hey, what happened? And he said, today at recess, Adrian told me to go back to Africa. And I was like, and I'm going to be really honest. In that moment, I was a bit stunned. I was like, you know, you're trying to like tell your body to catch up with your brain and like process. And I'm over here like, come on, Britt, you do this for a living. Get it together. Right? Like, ah. And my friend Mary's standing right there. And so she could overhear it. And so she turns and was just like, Kobe, I am so sorry that Adrian said that. He should have never said that to you, and that's not okay. So when she said that, it kind of like triggered something in me, like, oh, yeah, that's right. Okay, respond. We can do it, right? Like, compartmentalize and debrief with Mary later. So we get in the car, and I'm like, hey, let's talk about it on the way home, because, of course, I still have to pick up my other kid. So I'm like, let's talk about it on the way home. And long story short, what happened was they were at recess and another friend of Kobe's came up to him and said, and had reported to him, hey, Adrian said that his dad said, if you don't like it here, you can go back to Africa. And when he reported it to Kobe, they were together in a group of friends and they all were like, no, I don't think he would say that. Like, Adrian might be mean, but he's not like racist. So his friend was like, no, I just went over there and I asked him and he said that, like he's saying that. And I asked Kobe, so then what happened? And Kobe was like, well, I had two friends that were like, stay here. We're going to go talk to Adrian. So they went over there. They told Adrian, what you said was not okay. It was mean. It's not true. And then Kobe belongs here too. And Kobe said at that point, he started crying a bit and his teacher came over to check on him. Kobe had reported and his teacher said, let's talk about it. I'll talk with you and then I'm going to talk with Adrian and we're going to have a conversation together. And after they had their conversation together, Kobe said he felt fine. Like he said his piece, he advocated for himself. And he was like, and I know that that's used as a slur, but I don't think that that's a slur. I don't think Africa is a slur. And so we were in the car and I'm like, how do you feel now? How can I support you? What do you need me to do? Do you want me to talk to your teacher? And he's like, nope, she's already handled it. I said, okay, well, do you want me to tell the counselor? And he goes, nope, because Miss Jessica already has me on the appointment books with the counselor too. And I was like, wow, okay, so then what is my role in this? Because by gosh, when we talk about raising antiracist children, they have done it. The children advocated for themselves. They told their friend by using their words, what you said was not okay and not going to be tolerated. The teachers did their jobs. The counselor did their job. And so now I'm here left with just gratitude. And then over the weekend, because of course, why do things always have to happen on Fridays? Like if you're a teacher, you got that in your core. So then over the weekend, I started getting these messages and was like, hey, I am so-and-so's parent and if this happened to my kid, I would want to know. So I'm just telling you. And it was like the most like kind of like dancey type long 3-paragraph text. And they're like, if you want to talk about it, great. But if not, that's okay too. And I just responded to, you know, I was a bit overwhelmed just with all of them. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Because the majority of Kobe's classmates are white. They're not black. They're not children of color. They are white, and it is apparent to me that their caregivers, their grown-ups, are doing the necessary work, which is beautiful because it all should not have to rest on my shoulders. I shouldn't have to, in that moment, help the teacher and be like, okay, this is how you respond. This is what you should say. This is what you can do. I shouldn't have to say, yes, this can, if it goes, if it is persistent, it can create race-based traumatic syndrome. So he does need to talk to the counselor. Like, they did it. They did it. And so a part of raising anti-racist children is for them to be able to identify, have awareness, but also know not just, yeah, we can identify it. We have awareness. We have language. That's where a lot of progressive folks get stuck right there. We can talk really good about it, but when it comes to the action piece, like, okay, well, how are we empowered? That's really where the anti-racism, it's an active practice, and we empower learners to say, and I remember talking to one of the dads, and he was like, you know, we just really try to tell our, they have twin daughters, we just really tell our daughters to be kind to everyone and to be nice to everyone and to include everyone. And I'm like, yeah, that's good. And what happens, though, when someone else is being intentionally exclusive? Like, you're going to have to be a little clearer with your kids. You're going to have to be able to draw a line to say, sometimes when you exclude people, you end up getting excluded. And that's how that works. And the truth is never going to be a bad thing. It's okay for their child to speak the truth. It's okay for your child to say, this might make some people uncomfortable, and it's rooted in the truth. It's rooted in our family values. So I wanted to share a little bit, and in the book, we also have questions that Tiffany Jewell and I co-created of questions to ask. So I do want to mention, when we put Kobe into the school, these were questions that I asked of the administrator. These were questions that I asked of the teachers. And it is a public school, so it's not as if it's a private school and we got to cherry pick, but it is a private school, and I wanted to know, where is it that I needed to meet them in their journey to make sure that this place, when we say a space should be safe for children, how are we actively making it safe beyond I put up some posters or I feel that it's safe for me? How are we actively doing that?
When I heard that story, truly wild story, the thing that stuck out for me, sorry, am I too close to my face? I can't tell with volume. The thing that stuck out for me, aside from, wow, a school with actual, like, administrative, like, structural support oriented around this, revolutionary, what's that like? Love it. The thing that also I was shocked and very, very happy to hear was that the fellow students and the fellow parents showed up in community. I think, and this is something that I talked about with Britt when we started bringing the book into being, is that there's a lot of books on empathy, books on anti-racism, books on kind of revolutionizing like your mindset around this that are so individualized. They are so oriented towards the self, self-growth, adulthood, adults. Like, I feel like this book is one of the only books that actively is thinking about, hey, let's broaden the scope a bit. I don't think we are the only one, but I think that there are so many conversations and like articles and books about, oh, here's how you work on the self. But the whole point is that that's not successful, right? That's not the way that we're going to look after each other, is if we're just holding all of this in here and then we go, well, I've done the work, so I'm good. We have to show up for everyone else. And this was an instance where you had parents contacting you, you had a parent talking to Kobe, you had other students advocating for Kobe, you had structural administrative support advocating for Kobe in both like the moment and like after to process together. And you can't start soon enough, in my opinion, laying the groundwork for community, right? And it's starting here in a way with this partnership, right, of these three schools coming together. Your child is entering its own community in this classroom. You also are a part of a community in your neighborhood with your family. Showing and modeling that you are conscientious and that you care and are aware of the well-being and safety of everyone in your community is anti-racism. And that story just highlighted that they're working on it in, like, a really inspirational way. I wonder, who was, like, the consultant to, like, help make that administrative change possible?
She
sounds great.
Yes, that's interesting enough. When the principal had approached me and was like, will you be our anti-racist consultant? And I'm like, is there a conflict of interest there? And she's like, it's not for us if it's not for you. And I was like, okay. So that was also really helpful that I didn't feel like I had to put on a hat and send an email about like how to respond. But in fact, the practices we put in place happened. And that's what we need to see in schools. While we had a dozen other things that we want to talk about, I'm also being very mindful of the time. And one of my favorite things to do is the Q&A section, because I want this really meaningful for you. And I know that there's probably some really amazing, powerful, wonderful questions in the audience. If you are thinking of a question, be bold, be brave, and they will come to you. So all you have to do is raise your hand.
Could you also, when saying your name, give us your pronouns, please? Thank you.
I should add, if you feel comfortable.
Yes. Just want to make sure we're honoring the way you want to be referred to.
You know it is your turn if no one else is talking.
I think we solved it. I think we answered any question they ever had.
I knew I was good. We will wake up tomorrow and all.
Oh, praise be, volunteered as tribute.
Teresa, she, her. What happened to Adrian's dad?
I don't know.
Did you speak? You didn't speak to him?
No, and a few of the parents had asked if I was going to talk to Adrian's dad, and I made the conscious decision early on, no, because my child didn't do anything wrong. If Kobe, and Kobe has done things that are wrong, just like all kids have done something that's wrong, then I do make that effort to say, hey, I don't know if you know about this, but I think my child and your child had a conflict. Can we talk about it to try to get on the same page? But Kobe didn't do anything wrong in the situation. And so to me, it's on their parents to reach out. And if their parents didn't reach out, that gives me a clear signal. You're not trying to make peace. You're not trying to make amends. And so I make peace with you. And I think that's a really important kind of two key things in that. One is one of the practices that I teach my school clients is that when race-based harm happens or identity-based harm happens to a child, that child does not have to engage in conflict resolution if that child doesn't want to. And that is not standard procedure. Usually what's standard procedure is the opposite thing. So when something happens, someone says, oh, I can only have one best friend that's black, or you can't sit here, you have dark skin. Something like that happens, right? Usually then what a teacher will do is say that both of you need to come together and have a conversation and we need to come to a new understanding. And usually, when do we think that conversation happens in the school day? When does that happen? Recess, lunch, ancillary, studio time. Does your child like those days, those times of the day? They're literally looking forward to it. So not only did they have to experience it, they now are being punished again and missing out on that time. When did they do anything wrong? Did they do anything wrong? No, they didn't. And so it's really on the adult to do the adult's job to say, I can have a conversation with the child, whether you want to be present or not. And I can talk with the child, we will get on the same page, and we will work this out. So it's really important that we ask children of the golden majority or the child that experienced the harm, how can we make it better? And if they say, like, I wanna talk to them, I wanna go to the peace table, I wanna have conflict resolution, I wanna go through our steps, great, they get to do that. And if they're like, I have my eye on that kickball, and I have been waiting all day to beat Garrett at kickball. I'm like, you go have fun, sweetheart. Enjoy kickball. I hope you win. If not, we'll probably have another conflict resolution later today. And I can have this conversation with the child. And I think it's also the same thing with adults. And another question that sometimes I'll receive from school clients is, should we have both parents come into the office and talk about it? And that's one that I always say I would not do. If parents want to facilitate that conversation outside of school, they can and they should. I'm going to say they can and they should, because we are modeling for children that mistakes belong here too. And when we make a mistake, what do? We fix it. We repair. We make amends. you say, oh, that happened. Or sometimes it's not a mistake. Sometimes it's a poor choice. Like that was an intentional choice, right? And then we say, I made that poor choice and I want to make a different choice because I am a human being. I am not a tree. I am not a lion. I get to change. And so that repair oftentimes when we make a poor choice is a lot longer and it's a lot harder. And so because the parents did not reach out, they did not want to engage, which was quite surprising because our kids have had a relationship. Like Kobe has been to his birthday party, he's been to his house, he's been to our house. So they're not strangers. But if you have not built the muscle to know how to be in relationship with people, to how to take accountability on the small stuff, y'all, just the small stuff. Hey, I know we invited everyone to our birthday party except your child. That was a mistake. We got the class list. We missed your name. We didn't mean for it to happen. I am so sorry that your child felt left out because we left them out. It shouldn't have happened. How can we make it better? The small stuff, y'all. If you don't know how to make amends on that small stuff, when this stuff comes, oh, it's going to look like a big mountain. It's going to be Mount Everest. And it's just going to be too easy to just try and self-isolate and be like, maybe I won't ever see them at pick up and drop off again. I'll just hide in my car and zoom off. Right? It's going to be far too easy. So I will say definitely work on that accountability, making amends, having those conversations.
Well, I was going to say, can I share
a question,
a related story to this?
Yeah.
That when I was, I think in third grade, kids found out that I was Jewish and then made fun of me for it, which, okay, how original. But they were like, haha, she's Jewish. And I was like, yes. And I knew that that was like a not great thing that just happened to me. And I like rushed over to the teacher and I was like, Mr. I don't know, whatever, Brown. I don't know what his name was. They just made fun of me for being Jewish. And then he was like, oh, okay. And he got the two boys and me, took us outside in the middle of like a creative work session that everyone else got to have. And then he had us all stand outside and he went, now, boys, everyone believes in different things. I, for example, believe that Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior, and Tasha doesn't. And we just need to accept that. And I remember being like, this isn't how it was supposed to go. And the boys were just sort of like looking like, can we go back inside? I don't think they learned anything from that interaction. I know I did.
Yeah.
So I also think it's interesting to be like, if you are in a position of power where it is your responsibility to address a moment of tension or pain or violence that occurred, be sure that you, oh, I don't know.
Address it
and maybe aren't going to perpetuate that harm. And if you are unsure, that's the time to look for resources and that's the time to fall back on your administration for support. Because even now I can LOL about it. But as a kid, I was sort of like, okay, well, I guess I'll just go back inside and feel bad.
It's so amazing how, like, when we have conversations, whether it's about anti-Semitism or racism or sexism, that we have normalized the fact that not only will the person experience it, but then somehow it's also their fault too. And there's, like, really not this language or muscle to be built around, no, if the children said that what you said was wrong, that's not okay, and it shouldn't happen, and it won't happen again in the classroom, what questions do you have for me? Like, just as simple as that, right? Children learn best when language is clear, direct, concise, and there's some strong boundaries. Because are children going to push boundaries? Yeah, because they actually don't even know the boundary. So they are literally ramming up against it, trying to figure out, like, so what is the boundary? Because I don't know. I'm trying to figure it out. So that situation is a perfect situation. It didn't offer anyone any clarity, direction, boundary, nothing.
Well, it was clear that Jesus Christ was his Lord and Savior.
Have you ever seen?
I came away very clear about a lot.
Yeah. There's that funny, like, reel, and I think it's like a dog chasing, and they did a voiceover with the dog and was like, hey, wait, I want to tell you that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. No, no one saw that? Okay, never mind. Never mind.
Yeah, I saw it in third grade. Any other questions?
Yeah,
what question
questions
right
do you
here.
Have?
Back here.
Yeah, I'm just curious. So in a situation where race-based harm is caused,
How would you suggest the administration work with the child who committed the offense to like understand how impactful it is? Because I know, you know, like not letting them go to recess, that's not really teaching the student how much of an impact those statements have. How would you suggest administration respond?
I want to make an assumption, but tell me if I'm wrong. Are we talking ages like 3 to 5, 3 to 6 years old?
I did not have an age range in mind, but sure.
Okay, because I do...
Evergreen.
I think that age is so important in their developmental stage. So if it's 3 to 5, let's say you have a child that is like really resistant to playing with or working with children that have darker skin than them, right? If that's the case, then go ahead and allow the separation to happen because the child with the darker skin doesn't need to experience that, right? And then with that child, there's so many different things that you can do, whether it's pulling in baby dolls, figurines, pulling in books, pulling in materials, showing different videos, and talking about skin color, and helping them to have language and clarity using some science-based information with them. So you might say, like, wow, I have skin, and do you have skin? That is so cool. Like, we all have skin. And you might talk a little bit about, like, did you know that for grown-ups, sometimes our skin weighs 8 pounds? And so if it's, like, autumn, you can bring in a pumpkin, and you can have them hold that pumpkin and be like, this is so much, right? You can talk about the ways that you care for your skin. You can ask them, how do you care for your skin? What do your grown-ups do? Do you put on lotion? Do you put on coconut oil, shea butter? What type of soap do you use? So you can talk about, like, everyone cares for their skin. Sometimes people use different things at home, but we all have it. And then you might want to talk about melanin. Like, oh, I'm lighter than you. I'm paler than you. I'm fairer than you. You're darker than me. You have more melanin than me, right? And you might say, like, melanin is just this invisible stuff that gives us our skin color, and everybody has just the right amount of melanin for them. So you just help them to understand that. Some people have more melanin than other people. And the more melanin you have, the darker the color that you have. The less melanin, the lighter the color. And your genetics or your ancestors or your parents will dictate how much melanin that you have. But again, you just have the right amount of melanin. So having those conversations, if children are 3 to 5, because to your point, punishing a child is not going to work. They did not at all understand, have any type of clarity, language, or practices whatsoever around it. If, let's say, a child is saying something like, but their skin is dirty. Their skin is dirty. They haven't taken a bath. That just lets you know, because children are so concrete, right? That lets you know, wow, they have an association brown with dirt. And when you think about children's literature, children's media, how many times do we show dirt as brown? All the time, right? As if dirt does not come in all types of colors. Like, think about it. All types of colors. So you might have them play in flour if they don't have, like, a gluten allergy. You could have them play in flour, and they can get dirty. You could add a little water if you want, and that way it can be, like, a little bit of, like, a tan to it. You can do that. You can have them play with Play-Doh, and then you're just starting to have this association with, like, oh, my hands are dirty. Your hands are dirty. Look, we're dirty. You may touch their hands if they feel comfortable. They can touch your hands, like, you can touch it. And now let's wash it off. And you can always reassure them, though. People with darker skin, brown skin, medium brown skin, like, nope, I know they're clean. I watch them wash their hands. Their hands are clean. Are your hands clean? Do you need to go wash them? 20 seconds, sing happy birthday. Right? Like, you can always recenter them in that conversation. But 3 to 5, it's so important that we're giving them concrete activities, things that are hands-on, that we are connecting and engaging with them. Is that helpful?
Thank you.
Absolutely.
And that those can be done both at the home and in the classroom, mm-hmm. right? It's not isolated work. Things don't happen in a vacuum. This is continued work that we can put into practice all over the place, all the time, with all different kinds of members of our community.
Thank you. Right up in front.
Brianna, she, her. You know, you're saying, like, you're never too young to start doing this practice, and those examples you were giving were not, like, explicitly, like, racism, you know, conversation. What is that balance between, like, giving them some learning points before they ask or make a comment or something, like feeding them something before you're kind of reacting to something that comes up.
Yes, we spent a large amount of the book talking about preparing an anti-racist home. And so while you're preparing your anti-racist home and you're physically preparing it, it means that you are also spending that time working on yourself too and working with your peers, which are your parenting partners. So anyone who's involved in raising your child, and that you're doing that work. So that's a big part of the anti-racist piece. So in our household, for instance, when our children were under 6 years old, we had an explicit agreement and directions that our children would only watch television shows. Yes, my children watch screen time. I know, everyone clutch your pearls. So that they would only watch shows that had people of the golden majority or would have black protagonists in the show. If the show had majority were white folks or all white folks, we did not watch it. So that's one piece. And then that lays a foundation so that when our children were about 6 or 7 and they're more elementary age and they're talking with their friends, they're coming home and they're asking like, oh, can we watch this show? Or they're watching this on YouTube. We can then start to have this conversation about like, I notice, you know, this group is missing. I notice they don't have X type of character. I'm curious. I wonder why. And do you think that that's a form of racism? Now, usually children will say, when you ask them, do you think that's a form of racism? They're going to say, no, because they have already learned that racism has to be something that's violent, right?
Shout out to your dad.
Right. He learned it too. And instead, we can say it actually is a form of racism. It's called erasure. When no one is present, that's not truth. It's not accuracy. It's not reality, especially when we're talking about like fictional shows. Like this is all make-believe anyways, right? Like Kobe loves watching Disney. I'm like, it's just made up. So at least we could have a little bit of representation and truth in it. So it's really important when they're really young that you're laying a foundation of how you are preparing your home so that when they're about 6, 7, 8, that's my recommended age where you can start to have these very explicit conversations like, what's your definition of racism? And they're like, ah, and they like try to put it together and you're like, yeah, let's build on it. The reason why I recommend that age is in order for you to truly understand the context of racism, again, or any identity-based racism, you have to also be able to understand and experience time, right? So if they're still saying things like when I'm going to go to Nana's house, when the sun goes up and then it comes, and then it goes down and then it goes up. We know that they're not really ready to experience time. That's what happens then when I would teach Upper L and you would get students because whose birthday is coming up? Yay! Right? And so you would like show a picture of him and you'd be like, do you know who he is? And everyone's like, yes, that is Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And you're like, tell me about him. And they're like, he was a slave who marched for freedom. And you're like, oh, let's build on it. Let's build on it, right? Like, you clearly got some pieces. You've put it together, like 200 years of history. But we're working on it. So what happens is when we start to introduce things really young, things get really choppy even when they're older. And you've said, like, but I've talked to them. I've showed them. I've told them. It's because they didn't have that concept of time in that way. Right? Or if you tell them stories about Mrs. Parks, you tell them stories about Trayvon Martin or about George Floyd, and they're like, it happened yesterday. And you're like, let's build on that. Okay? So I recommend 6, 7, 8 when you want to really start to explicitly say, let's unpack it. Let's break it down. What do you know? I love a good scroll. So like, get a timeline out. Let's put it on the timeline. What do we know? What do we want to learn, and where are we going to get this information from and start to build from there?
Hi, so my name is Julia, and you can use she, they pronouns with me. I just want to say it's really refreshing to hear you use the term global majority, people of the global majority. And I don't know if people in this room have heard it that much, so and I'm wondering if you can break it down in your book a little bit.
Also
am wondering whether indigenous folks, would they fit in that or not?
We have a glossary section, folks.
I know. Excuse me. I don't know why I'm looking in the index. Like, I don't know where it is.
What do we mean by global majority when we say that?
Okay, in full transparency, I left my copy of my book at home. And so this is not my copy. I purchased this copy from Book Inks in the back. Shout out. And what do we mean by people of global majority on page 17? I'm going to get the opportunity to read from my book, so thank you. We chose to use the term people of the global majority, or POGM, a term coined by Dr. Barbara J. Love, because it directly disrupts white supremacy. There are more people of color in this world than white people. Yet media, educational curricula, and pop culture continue to center white people. The term people of the global majority acts to challenge this myth. In the United States, POGM have a shared history of being pushed out, denied access, made to feel perpetually othered, and not American enough. White people, however, are seen as neutral. They are the assumed default, always centered in the conversation. Black people, indigenous people, brown people, Latine or Latinx peoples, particularly indigenous Afro, Latine, Latinx, Pacific Islanders, Native Hawaiians, the Inuit communities, Alaska Natives, Native Americans, Arabs, Western Asians, Middle Easterns with dark skin, North Africans, Southeast Asians, South Asians, East Asians, Africans with dark skin, and biracial and multiracial people who are mixed with one or more of the above, and people and groups of people who can't fully access white privilege are people of the global majority. And this isn't a perfect definition. It's important to keep in mind that there are both white and non-white folks who hold different ethnicities that are also targeted by white domination. We acknowledge this complicates the narrative that white domination works so hard to simplify. And last but not least, we want to make sure that you know lumping all of these groups together into one category can be a form of erasure. If you're discussing a particular group or groups, just refer to that particular identity. Does that sound good?
Can I talk about why I love this?
Yeah. I love how you're asking, can I? And I'm like,
I'd like to talk about why I love this.
You don't need my permission.
I want to defer and refer.
I love it. Which is in the book.
Yes. Yes, it is. We've talked about community a million times today, and I think the thing that I love about people of the global majority is that it creates a community while also honoring the micro communities within, the micro identities within. It is specifically also a community of the minoritized experience, which is different from the minority experience. Part of the reason why we say global majority is because we are not minorities, right? We are minoritized by the continued placement of whiteness, of heterosexuality, of cisgenderedness as the primary, the only, the Platonian ideal. Changing minority to minoritized, that active verb, talking about a global community of folks, while different, sharing that relationship to white domination, to white supremacy, is such an active way to view and discuss why they are minoritized, just through the naming of it, as a great starting place.
Yeah, and it's one of those things I love having curious questions with children, right? So I might ask my children when they were younger, if you were to guess, do you think there's more white people in the world or more people of color? What do you think most children would say? Yeah, because it's who's visibilized, right? And so when you start to share people of global majority, and then you say, let's work together to kind of come up with, and that's what we did, right? Like, I've been using this phrase, people of global majority, and then it was time for us to write the book. And I was like, oh, I'm going to have to work together. And a lot of this book was because of the work I've done with my children. So it's like, together, who are we talking about? What are we talking about? And so you can do the same thing with your children at home. Like, it's not necessarily about reading this definition and just telling your children, but it's co-creating together. Who are we talking about when we're talking about people of the global majority? But the first part of the book is just developing an understanding, and we have a lot of shared language, whether it is white domination or people of global majority, minoritized, or racism. But we try to have this emphasis on what is developmentally appropriate language to use with children that will emphasize critical thinking. But also a big part of this work with children is that we're system blaming and not person blaming. And that is a huge difference. Right? I think about when I grew up, and if I asked my parents about folks who were unhoused, they would just like make up fictional stories, right? That it was supposed to be, I guess, like maybe a legend or a fable that I was going to learn from, of like, oh, well, they didn't listen to their teacher, or they didn't do their homework. That's what happens when you drop out of school.
Wild parable. Wild.
Yeah. And I'm like, do you know that person? Okay. Right. And it was supposed to be, I guess, like they used their experience as my teachable moment, but I didn't learn anything. And instead, I remember when we had first moved to Houston and Carter was about 9 years old, and I was on my way to what I call the laundromat, but in Houston, we call it a washateria. So we're on our way to the washateria, and I'm just at a stoplight, and Carter's like, Mom, why do those people live underneath the bridge? And I realized where we had moved from, there's not a large unhoused population that's visible to us. And so in that moment, I'm like, oh, you are noticing unfairness, aren't you? Yeah. And I have a Montessori background, and my kids went to Montessori schools, and so we talk about fundamental needs. And we can talk about, why is shelter so important? What does it do for us? Why is it important that humans have shelter? Right? It keeps us safe from inclement weather. It keeps our belongings safe. That's kind of a neat thing as humans, that we carry belongings. We carry our belongings with us. And I'll be really honest, sometimes when I'm at the airport, I don't know why it makes me giggle. And I'm like, because, you know, you just don't see a cricket carrying a bag. Right? You don't just see like a baby elephant just carrying a carry-on. And I just think that's so neat. I'm like, oh, just look at us, just carrying our belongings, pushing the shopping cart. We're like, I have to have, today I have two bags with me. Why? It smells like safety nets. So we talk about that. And then I can say, well, in Texas, you know, we don't have a livable wage. I can also say in Houston, while they have made leaps and bounds in trying to cut the unhoused population and offer affordable housing, we still do not invest enough in affordable housing. I can say, you know what? People need mental health services. It is not free. It is not accessible. It's not easy to get. It's not easy to sustain. People work long hours. And that is how we system blame. So once we can accurately identify, we can say, what do you want to do about it? And of course, Carter, looking at all my quarters for the washateria, was like, can we give him the quarters? And I'm like, I would, but we do need to do laundry for the week. This is not like a nice to have, this is a must have. I wonder if we could do some other things. I said, you know, we could write letters to the mayor, to our alderman. We can write letters to the senator. Carter was like, who writes letters? We could just tweet them. I was like, you're right. Okay, I'm a little old school there, right? But once we can accurately identify the system, then we can move to action with our kids. Are you laughing at me?
No.
Okay.
Never.
So having that accurate language, being able to system blame and get away from person blaming. When children are really young, you're gonna just hear me say this again and again, critical thinking, y'all, critical thinking. If we really wanna solve a problem, then we actually have to diagnose the problem. Do we have time for one more?
We're gonna take one more question back up here. Wanna remind everybody that Britt and Natasha are gonna be signing books back here. Books Inc. with Ingrid back here.
Come support say hi Books later. Inc. Yeah.
Hi, my name's Alexis, she, her. Pardon me, this isn't like a totally conceptualized thought, but I have three white boys, and so I think a lot about how to explain to them that they are seen differently than anyone else in a lot of ways. And I think particularly for my oldest, who's in second grade and is 8 years old, we talk a lot about advocating for other people. I love this idea of like system blaming, because he was like shocked when I explained to him like how white people came to this country and basically we kidnapped people to do our work for us. And those things I think he has an understanding of. But when we talk about advocating for other people because the systems don't, I want him to be able to do that and also think about his safety in situations as well. And I know I have the benefit of like letting him step in and out of that, but I want to challenge myself while also keeping him safe in the world and being an advocate for people that don't have that voice in the larger system.
Yeah, it really sounds like there could be a practice or an activity around the difference between being uncomfortable and unsafe, right? And that's probably a really good practice for anyone with your child at any age, right? And if you're unsafe, and the reason why it's important that that's a practice is because your body's going to code it the same. And too often our body is coding something as uncomfortable, and so we leave. We're like, I am out of here. And so it's important that you are, when it happens even with you, I'm going to share just such a short, I promise.
I was going to say, this is applicable to adults too.
It'll be so short. So I was homeschooling Kobe, and we were at the public library. And long story short, there was a librarian who went over and told some teenage girls, you are in the children's section, you are not kids, you need to leave. And basically said it like that. And I kind of watched this, honestly, in some like shock and horror. And the librarian walked away, and we're there. And again, like I said, I was homeschooling Kobe. So I'm there and other parents are there, and we're all there with our really small children, because it, you know, how they'll have like the story time and the mommy and me yoga and all of that. So we're there. We all witnessed this happen. And I was earlier on my anti-racist journey, and I just remember sitting there and my body, like I had brain fog and my body was like uncomfortable. So much so, I remember being like, maybe I should just leave. Like, and then I had asked myself, like, girl, are you unsafe or are you uncomfortable? I am in a public library during mommy and me yoga. Like, no harm is coming to me at all. You are an adult in this situation, and those are children, right? And I remember, like, having to have that internal dialogue with me. Like, check yourself. And so when I'm able then to say, you know what? Because conflict, I grew up normal, like just conditioned that conflict makes me uncomfortable, right? I don't want to be a part of it. If I see it, then I think that like now if I'm in it, now that I'm a bad person and that conflict is bad, right? Like that whole thing I had to learn to unpack, I talk more about in the book. And so instead I was able to be like, this doesn't sound right at all, because we are in Houston. It is a major city. And has some of the highest rates of human trafficking in the United States, because we have the airports, we have the ports for the sea, we have a huge transplant international population, and I know this information. And she wants to send these two girls, like either out into the street or on the adult side. And I don't know if anybody's been in a public library on the adult side, but they take freedom of speech and what you want to do on the computer very loosely, right? So it's like, okay, if you want to watch that on the computer in the public library. And everybody knows what I'm talking about. Okay, so I'm like, I don't know about this. So I go up to the girls and I just ask their permission. I was like, I don't think what she said was right. Do you want my help? And they were like, yes. And I got the feeling because one, they didn't move, which showed me that they were trying to be defiant, but two, they didn't have any language. So they were just staying put. And so when the librarian came back over and the librarian was like, it's been 5 minutes, your time is up, you need to leave. I was able to step in and be like, I heard what you had said to them and I do belong here. I have a small kid. Thank you so much for protecting all the young children. I appreciate that. And they are minors and this is the most protected space for them. So can you show me the written rule that they're not allowed to be here? Because a fun fact, people who uphold white domination love rules. They love written rules. They will like tell you in a heartbeat, it's a rule. And you're like, okay, clearly you didn't take a philosophy class. One more time. So I was like, do you have a written rule? And she was really stumped. She was like, well, I just know it's a rule. And I go, I just need to see it. And then we can take it from there. So she goes in the back, and then her supervisor comes out. And I'm like, yeah, it's me. I'm the one rocking the boat, causing the conflict. I'm a bad person. No, right? And like in that moment, I was like, it's me. So she comes over. She's like, hey, I heard what happened, and I just want to say a big thank you, because we actually have this huge initiative and grant to try to get teenagers in here, and we can't figure out why we can't get them in here. And I'm like, oh, really? Tell me more. It's amazing when you have like diversity initiatives that don't work out because we didn't do training. And I'm like, oh, she's like, so actually, yeah, the rule is that if they're a minor, they can be in the children's area. Anyone 18 and older needs to be on the adult area unless they have a small child. So thanks. And I was like, okay, do you think that the librarian will come out and tell the girls that? And she goes, she said she's going to finish her shift in the back. I was like, okay, I will tell the girls. So I think having that practice between, are you uncomfortable or are you unsafe? And if you're uncomfortable, stay. It is your work, and it's okay for you to lead by saying, like, I'm really uncomfortable. I'm not for sure what to do. How can I help? And if you're unsafe, I'm always going to advocate you can leave the situation. You can leave. All right.
Can I just say one final thing, which is kind of circling back to the very beginning of the conversation when talking about our guidelines, right? This is going to be work that takes a long time, and it's going to be, in many ways, never ending. It doesn't have enough, like, you don't have to solve a whole lot in a single conversation with your children. Start with a simple priority, start with a small success, and just work your way up in a way where, yes, you are experiencing discomfort or they are experiencing discomfort, but you don't feel overwhelmed with what you're trying to accomplish with those conversations. It's an ongoing conversation. It's an ongoing process that we are all learning. You don't have to rush. You just have to commit.
Thank you so much, everyone, for coming tonight. I truly, truly appreciate y'all.
I know. Thank you, everyone.
And I just want to leave just a couple words of encouragement that I don't know if you're feeling exhausted, tired, kind of just with what is happening in the war, in the world, particularly the conflict that is happening right now in Gaza. And I want everyone to know that I want you to feel empowered to stay engaged. To stay engaged, to continue to build your level of awareness, to continue to get your information from the sources, to continue to have conversations with your children. I thought someone might ask this question, but since you didn't, I'm diving in. You're going to get a little more information. And that it's that if you're trying to have that conversation with your child, you can always start with, what do you know? What do you know? We do not want our children to think that if they talk to us about it, that they're going to upset us. They're going to make us uncomfortable. They're hearing things. They're getting information. It's important that we build connection and that we're responding to them and that we're telling them, you don't have to figure it out alone. Okay? Tricky conversations are welcomed here too, and that we are always in this household going to center justice. We will always center truth. We will always center justice. We will always center humanity and love.
And agree on community guidelines with them. Approaching with curiosity, approaching with empathy, compassion, taking a break when you need it. They get to have a say in their boundaries and their modes of communication as well, just like you. So, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.